Good morning and welcome to your online digital worship for Trinity United Church of Christ in Canton, Ohio for Sunday, October 8th, 2023. This Sunday, even though it's the second Sunday of the month, we are offering communion at the service in person at Trinity. We will also be having the communion service here on this video, so please gather whatever you would like as your elements so we can partake together after the sermon.
Hi, my name is Ashley Miltner, the Director of Christian Education here at Trinity United Church of Christ in Canton.
Beware of them spooks, 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 them mischievous.
I would like to invite you to this year's Trunk or Treat at Trinity UCC from 2 to 4 p.m. in our parking lot. We will have food trucks, a balloon artist, and an inflatable obstacle course.
Time when you wail, see here, you make it loud and clear. Watch out for them spooks, spooks, spook of those nasty old spooks, spooks.
We hope you join us this year for our fall festivities.
Good morning, Trinity. It is so exciting that we have so many new folks joining us, visitors that have been back many times, new members and new people in our pews. In order to help you all understand where we came from, what we are all about, all the offerings that Trinity has, we're offering two classes, October 15th and October 22nd. Those two Sundays at 11 a.m. immediately following the service, we will head down to the chapel and have our time together there. You can ask any questions you may have. I'll let you guys know what I know about the church, and hopefully we can have some great time and fellowship. After the classes, we will offer lunch for everyone that's there, so please join us for that. We'll order some lunch, sandwiches, subs, pizza, something fun like that. And we welcome you all to learn a little bit more about this place. And then, if you are so moved, but you certainly don't have to, you are welcome to join the church on Sunday, November 19th. It's a Sunday right before Thanksgiving, and we're going to have a potluck on that day as well. Hope to see you all there. This morning, we have our fourth sermon in the sermon series entitled It's a Miracle, looking at the miracles of Jesus for 10 weeks. This morning, we are going to look actually at three different miracles, all involving Jesus feeding the people. We all probably are familiar with the feeding of the 5,000, the miracle of the loaves and fishes, but we're also going to talk about the miraculous catches that Jesus has of fish in the Sea of Galilee. We're going to look at three different scriptures this morning. The first is from Matthew. Then we have Luke and then John. The first comes from Matthew chapter 14, verses 15 to 21. When it was evening, the disciples came to him and said, "This is a deserted place, and the hour is now late. Send the crowds away so that they may go into the villages and buy food for themselves." Jesus said to them, "They need not go away. You give them something to eat." They replied, "We have nothing here but five loaves and two fish." And he said, "Bring them here to me." Then he ordered the crowds to sit down on the grass. Taking the five loaves and the two fish, he looked up to heaven and blessed and broke the loaves and gave them to the disciples, and the disciples gave them to the crowds. And all ate and were filled. And they took up what was left over of the broken pieces, 12 baskets full. And those who ate were about 5,000 men, besides women and children. From the Gospel according to Luke, chapter 5, verses 1 to 11. Once while Jesus was standing beside the lake of Gennesaret, and the crowd was pressing in on him to hear the word of God, he saw two boats there at the shore of the lake. The fishermen had gone out of them and were washing their nets. He got into one of the boats, the one belonging to Simon, and asked him to put out a little way from the shore. Then he sat down and taught the crowds from the boat. When he had finished speaking, he said to Simon, "Put out into the deep water and let down your nets for a catch." Simon answered, "Master, we have worked all night long but have caught nothing. Yet if you say so, I will let down the nets." So when they had done this, they caught so many fish that their nets were beginning to break. So they signaled their partners in the other boat to come and help them. And they came and filled both boats so that they began to sink. But when Simon Peter saw it, he fell down at Jesus' knees, saying, "Go away from me, Lord, for I am a sinful man." For he and all who were with him were amazed at the catch of fish they had taken. And so also were James and John, sons of Zebedee, who were partners with Simon. Then Jesus said to Simon, "Do not be afraid. From now on, you will be catching people." When they had brought their boats to shore, they left everything and followed him. And our final scripture today comes from the last chapter of the Gospel according to John, chapter 21, verses 1 through 19. After these things, Jesus showed himself again to the disciples by the Sea of Tiberias, and he showed himself in this way. Gathered there together were Simon Peter, Thomas called the twin, Nathanael of Cana in Galilee, the sons of Zebedee, and two others of the disciples. Simon Peter said to them, "I am going fishing." They said to him, "We will go with you." They went out and got into the boat, but that night they caught nothing. Just after daybreak, Jesus stood on the beach, but the disciples did not know that it was Jesus. Jesus said to them, "Children, you have no fish, have you?" They answered him, "No." He said to them, "Cast the net to the right side of the boat, and you will find some." So they cast it, and now they were not able to haul it in because there were so many fish. That disciple whom Jesus loved said to Peter, "It is the Lord." When Simon Peter heard that it was the Lord, he put on some clothes, for he was naked, and jumped into the sea. But the other disciples came in the boat, dragging the net full of fish, for they were not far from land, only about 100 yards off. When they had gone ashore, they saw a charcoal fire there with fish on it and bread. Jesus said to them, "Bring some of the fish that you have just caught." So Simon Peter went aboard and hauled the net ashore, full of large fish, 153 of them. And though there were so many, the net was not torn. Jesus said to them, "Come and have breakfast." Now none of the disciples dared to ask him, "Who are you?" because they knew it was the Lord. Jesus came and took the bread and gave it to them, and did the same with the fish. This now was the third time that Jesus appeared to the disciples after he was raised from the dead. When they had finished breakfast, Jesus said to Simon Peter, "Simon, son of John, do you love me more than these?" He said to him, "Yes, Lord, you know that I love you." Jesus said to him, "Feed my lambs." A second time he said to him, "Simon, son of John, do you love me?" And he said to him, "Yes, Lord, you know that I love you." Jesus said to him, "Tend my sheep." He said to him the third time, "Simon, son of John, do you love me?" Peter felt hurt because he said to him the third time, "Do you love me?" And he said to him, "Lord, you know everything. You know that I love you." Jesus said to him, "Feed my sheep. Very truly I tell you, when you were younger, you used to fasten your own belt and to go wherever you wished. But when you grow old, you will stretch out your hands and someone else will fasten a belt around you and take you where you do not wish to go." He said this to indicate the kind of death by which he would glorify God. After this, he said to him, "Follow me." This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. This morning we have the fourth sermon in our sermon series on the miracles of Jesus. This morning I decided to tie together three different scriptures from three different gospels, all showing Jesus's generosity in feeding the flock, feeding his sheep, as he says to Simon Peter at the end. These all sound similar. There's connections between these stories. They all involve miracles of feeding the people, multiplying loaves and fishes, having a great catch with fishermen at the shore. We have so many connections that I wanted to put them all together to make a single point, which is that Jesus is all the food that we need. He will feed us spiritually. He will feed us in all the ways that we need if we just but rely and trust upon him. Looking at the longest scripture, the very end of the Gospel of John, John 21, this scripture is also not just about feeding and generosity, but it's about restoring our family relationship in Christ, in our church family, and with him, our Lord and Savior. In the end of John's gospel, the disciples are grieving, discombobulated, confused. Their entire lives have been turned upside down by what they witnessed at the cross. What they had learned to be true was no longer true. They didn't know what to do after Jesus' crucifixion before they saw the risen Christ, so they did the only thing they knew how to do. They went fishing. They went back home. They went back to the only livelihood, the only skills they had, the only thing they knew how to do. They went to their comfort zone in the midst of grief, loss, and complete disarray. But you see, they couldn't even do the one thing they knew how to do before they met Jesus. It wasn't working. They couldn't catch any fish. Jesus, incognito at the time, tells them to put the nets over here and not over there. And oh, do they get a catch when they listen to him. This scripture, as I said, comes from the final chapter in the gospel according to John. This is the lasting impression that the author of the gospel wished to leave with the reader at the end of the story of Jesus and his ministry. The closing thoughts, the final point, the most important thing. Most scholars believe that the original text of John's gospel ended at chapter 20, and that chapter 21, which we heard today, was added years later as an epilogue or even a summary of the story. This epilogue on the beach, the breakfast with Jesus, serves to provide reflection on all that had been written before, the miracles and the ministry of Jesus. Chapter 21 serves to make the most important points of Jesus' ministry one final time, reflected and concentrated into a final scene that provides relevance and hope for followers of Christ, all of us, 2,000 years later. The story takes place with disciples fishing on the shores and in boats on the Sea of Tiberias, which is another name for the Sea of Galilee. It all ends where it began, with Simon Peter fishing in Galilee. According to Luke's gospel, Jesus called Simon Peter, James, and John, the sons of Zebedee, as his first disciples with a miraculous catch way back at the beginning. They dropped everything and followed him. In the scripture from the 5th chapter of Luke, we heard today, Jesus performs a nearly identical miracle with the miraculous catch that we see in John 21 from the beginning to the end of his ministry, bracketed by this two almost identical miracles. And now the sons of Zebedee and Simon Peter, we're all back where they started, having been transformed by their years with Christ, but back to their familiar trade, as I said, back to their comfort zone. In today's scripture from John, the risen Christ calls them again by saying, "Follow me," which is what he said when he called them in the first place. He says, "Follow me," in verse 19 at the very end of what we heard today, just as he does when he calls them for the first time. Jesus says, "Follow me," in John chapter 1, verse 43, when calling Nathanael and Philip. And he says, "Follow me," to Andrew and Simon Peter in Matthew 4, 19. Just like Simon Peter, Nathanael is also at the shore when he meets the risen Christ in John 21. The disciples are trying to catch fish and come up empty until Jesus shows them the way. They catch nothing until he shows them where and how to fish. Then they catch 153 fish, an astounding abundance of fish. Jesus shows them the way. As I said, this scene is bracketed and almost identical to the one we heard from Luke 5, 1 through 11. Following Jesus' direction in both of them, they catch a huge amount of fish. But in the one from Luke 5, the nets begin to break. But this time in John 21, the nets do not break, and they are able to haul in the entire catch. That's almost the only difference in these miracle stories. The change in the situation might just be a metaphor for the disciples' evolution and understanding of Christ's message. They could not comprehend the miracles and thus the reality of Jesus at the beginning of their time with him in Luke 5. But now, in John 21, as he comes to the end of his time with them, his time with them as the risen Christ, they are strong enough in their faith to hold on and spread the gospel to others. They are now ready truly to be fishers of men after witnessing the resurrected Christ on the shore. This miracle, at the end of John's gospel, of course, harkens back to the famous miracle of feeding the 5,000 that we heard from Matthew's version of that story. Here, in John 21, with the risen Christ, the disciples eat a miraculous meal of bread and fish, recalling the miracle of feeding the 5,000, which we heard from Matthew 14, that is also echoed in Luke 9, Mark 6, and John 6. And in fact, it's the only miracle, as we look at all the miracle stories of Jesus, it's the only one that's in all four Gospels, feeding the masses. In John 21, the epilogue continues the summary of the story of Christ again, when Jesus shares breakfast with them, breaking bread with them as he did at the Last Supper. They did not recognize him at first sight. Just like in John chapter 20, Mary did not recognize Jesus at the empty tomb, mistaking him for the gardener. It takes the disciples a while to recognize the risen Christ in all of these stories. And finally, of course, the most important part of this scripture is that it is all about love, just as Jesus' message throughout the gospel and throughout the miracles in the gospel stories is all about love. This epilogue in John provides a final miracle which harkens back to so many other of the earlier miracles with one significant difference. This miracle is performed by the risen Christ, not the Christ in his earthly human form. This story moves the gospel narrative from the past into the present and provides a hopeful path forward into the future. This epilogue bridges the miracles of Christ before the resurrection with the history, legend, and the past, with the realities of the miracles that Christ is still doing in the world today, the living Christ with us today. The risen Christ began his work with the disciples he loved in that place that he loved, Galilee. But he commissions them, yet again, to get out from their familiar comfort zone into the unknown, the wide world, to spread the good news. He commissions them to leave the comfort of their fishing nets and home turf and proclaim God's undying love through the miracle of the risen Christ to the ends of the earth. This is a story of a commission, but it's also a story of redemption. I included the last part about Simon Peter very intentionally because right there we see how Peter is redeemed. Simon Peter is asked by Jesus three times if he loves him. And three times he responds that he does love Jesus. This, of course, is a parallel to Peter denying Jesus three times right after Jesus is arrested. Now, having seen and believed, Peter is ready to become an evangelist for the risen Christ. This moment where Peter has to answer three times for his three denials is a chance to redeem himself, to go from the blamed to the hero, from the stumbling block to the rock upon which the church shall be built. Peter, like the rest of us, has made some mistakes. He has strayed from his promises and has denied even knowing Jesus when the heat was on. Yet even Peter, poor Peter, can be redeemed when he proclaims his love for Jesus three times at the end of the Gospel of John. If there is hope for Peter, then I believe there is hope for all of us. Because Jesus will come looking for us. Even if we deny him or fail to see him for who he is, like the blind man, like the Pharisees, the blind man could see and they could not. Jesus will ask us if we love him, and we can answer this question with a resounding yes. We can answer Jesus with a resounding yes through our actions, by reaching out to those in need and loving them, serving them and treating all the lost sheep and the lambs with grace and dignity, truly feeding the sheep. And this is the good news for us today. Christ is still at work in the Word, performing miracles, feeding us, tending to us, even if we don't recognize him at first. It is because he is still at work loving us, that we are empowered to respond with this love to others. May we take the lessons of the miracles of Jesus feeding the people as sustenance. May we take hope in that and know that he will continue to feed us. But then he also calls us and commissions us, like he does the disciples at the end of John, to go out there and do greater signs and wonders than he did. May we take this commission call seriously. Amen. Called as Christ's disciples, we now gather at the table that he has prepared for us. We come to this table not because we are perfect, but because in our imperfections we seek communion with Christ Jesus. We come to this table not because we have it all figured out and we understand the miracle of the bread and the cup, but we come because we want to join in that fellowship that happened at the miracle, that we remember every time we take communion together. You are all invited to this table, whether you believe a little or a lot, whether you are baptized or not, because this table belongs to Christ and not to us. Let us pray. Gracious Lord, we give you thanks for this table. May this bread of life truly sustain us in all of our days forward. May this cup of hope truly remind us of the sacrifice that you made and what that sacrifice means to us. May we join together in the beloved community of Christians all around the globe as we take of this bread and cup today. We pray all these things as we pray the prayer that Jesus taught his followers, saying together, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. And every time we gather at this table, remember, it was on the night in which Christ Jesus was betrayed that he gathered with his disciples for a Passover meal in an upper room. And at that meal, he took a loaf of bread, he blessed it, and he broke it for all things that are broken in this world. And then Jesus said, Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me. And after the supper, he gave thanks for the fruit that grows on the vine. He took a cup. He poured that cup out. He blessed that cup, he offered that cup to them, and then they gave that cup new meaning when he said, This is the covenant shed in my blood. This do as often as you drink of it in remembrance of me. As often as we eat of this bread and drink of this cup, we proclaim Christ's crucifixion upon the cross as a glorious resurrection and say that we shall wait for him until he comes again. And for that, we give utmost thanks. Amen. And now we ask you to please give generously of your tithes and your offerings that we may continue the ministry and the missions here at Trinity United Church of Christ. We say thank you for giving, whether it's through eGive or the text to give program or by the envelope system, writing a check, dropping it off, mailing it into the church. However you give, we say thank you, thank you, thank you for your support. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May you go forth from wherever you are, remembering that Jesus feeds his people, that he is the bread of life and that is enough to sustain us through good days and bad. And may we share that bread and that love with all that we meet. Amen.